Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, and do all your Amazon shopping via the Amazon banner on the David Feldman Show website, and check out our premium content. You know the drill. I have a new best friend. We worked together at Caroline's Christmas week. We were opening for Judy Gold, who I no longer need anymore now that I have you. Josh Gondelman is a stand-up comedian. He's achieved recognition from co-creating the popular parody Twitter account Modern Seinfeld. He has since gone on to become a writer on the critically acclaimed HBO series Last Week Tonight and has written a new book titled You Blew It, an awkward look at the many ways in which you've already ruined your life. Welcome, Josh Gondelman.
Thank you for having me, new best friend, David.
My new BFF.
Forever.
Forever. Forever.
That's a lot of time to be a BF.
Yeah.
That's people tack it on there willy-nilly.
Yeah. Well, you're younger than I am, so it's not as much of a commitment as it is for me.
Totally. Yeah. Let's hope. I mean, No offense.
Well, I met you at Caroline's, and it was, you know, envy and jealousy at first sight.
Thank you.
Which I think is what a friendship is all about.
Certainly in comedy. I always think, like, with the highest compliment I can pay a comedian is, like, that joke was so good it made me hate you.
Yes.
That's, like, how I feel. Yeah, that's the best thing you can say about someone's act is, like, I'm furious at you that you thought of that and I didn't.
Who's your nemesis? My nemesis was Jake Johansson. Do you know Jake
really?
Johansson?
I do know Jake Johansson.
We started together.
Yeah.
And I thought it was a limited universe. Mm-hmm. And I was eating his dust, and I thought, how dare he do this to me? And how dare he be good? I love him.
He's great.
He's the best.
I just watched, I think it was the one when I got HBO Go, I was browsing through the HBO One Night Stands, and I watched his.
Well, he figured it out. I remember my father calling me saying, why can't you be like Jake Johansson? We both moved to San Francisco at the same time, and Jake Johansson figured out that stories are better than jokes.
Yeah.
And his Letterman shots, I think he holds the record for most Letterman shots.
I think that's true. I think it was like 37.
And I don't know why we haven't had him on the show. I think we've made several false attempts and then... but he was the guy, and I remember getting, when I used to drink, he won the San Francisco Comedy Competition. And I literally got drunk and pulled one of those, why you, not me?
Oh, sure.
Why? And he was just, you know, but you need a guy like that to make you better.
For sure. I don't think I have a personal nemesis that I have a grudge against, but I definitely have friends who, when I see them, I'm like, oh boy, I gotta do better. Like, I gotta be better. The last time I felt that way was, and he's an amazing comedian. Like, I feel like I'm a competent comedian.
You're a great comedian.
Well, thank you. But this guy, when I watch Sean Patton, I'm just like, oh boy, that's the thing I should be aspiring to. And Aparna Ninchela as well.
Mm-hmm.
Two people that I'm just.
Who just had a lovely piece in the New York Times.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah.
She's wonderful.
Uh-huh.
And so those two where I'm just like, oh, there's more on this bone that I'm not getting to.
Yeah. They're answering, like, I can't pronounce her name. What is her name again?
Mine? Or no. Aparna.
Aparna
Ninchela. Yeah.
Yeah. They are answering to a different comedy god than I am.
Yeah.
And they're not answering to the audience, which is, you know, the audience is either... Anyway, we'll move on.
But the audience, I will say the audience will answer to them. Do you know what I mean? Like, instead of doing the thing they think a crowd will like, they will do a thing that they like and be like, come to me, audience. Like, I'll bring you to me, which is, I commend that.
Yes. Josh Gondelman.
Yes.
One of the great last names of show business.
We were talking about it the other night. My friend Matt Marquis in high school pointed out to me first, but it's like very easy for someone to yell at you in anger is Gondelman. Gondelman!
Gondelman!
Gondelman! Get in my office!
Uh-huh.
So we were talking about that the other night. But yes, it's a great name to say furiously.
Where'd you grow up?
Just outside Boston in a little town called Stoneham, Massachusetts.
Stoneham?
Yeah. It is notable for being the hometown of Nancy Kerrigan. Olympic medalist
who had weak ankles,
knees,
weak
wasn't
knees.
It? Yeah, that's, well, I mean, they
well,
were
Tanya Harding.
Yeah, they were structurally impaired by outside forces. But
I remember 1994, And yeah, and most people deep in their heart were rooting for Tanya. There was something I don't want to say Nancy. I don't want to trash Nancy.
No,
Kerrigan.
But see, I can't even feel that because we're so. Not only is she from my town, but that's that New England like spite of like one of us against everybody. So I have to like. It could have come out later that like she got her figure skating ability from like unhinging her jaw and swallowing a baby whole. But I'd still be like, nah. But she's from my hometown and. She's a good shit, Bad Nancy.
And who was the guy, the Tanya Harding?
Jeff Galooly? Galooly, was like her husband
Svengali.
Or ex-husband. Yeah, Svengali. Like Svengali.
You grew up in Massachusetts. Did you start doing comedy in Massachusetts?
Yeah, I did. I started when I was in college in Boston. I went to Brandeis, and then I would like take a bus into the city and do spots, and then do a lot of stuff on campus, too.
Brandeis College? Yeah. Abby Hoffman went to Brandeis.
Abby Hoffman?
Very
yeah.
Jewish. Is it still very Jewish?
It's still very Jewish, certainly.
Yeah. What was it? Was Brandeis set up? I don't know if Justice Brandeis was the first Jewish.
Justice?
Yeah. I don't know if he was
I think so.
Or first openly Jewish.
Sure. I think that's true.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure about it.
And is he the one who said sunshine is the great disinfectant?
I don't know.
Because I'll tell you, it isn't.
Did not cure E. coli.
It did not. My great grandmother died of polio, and
amount of vitamin D. injections full of sunshine.
Right. Well, they invented Brandeis because Harvard, I believe, found that they were getting too many Jews when they were doing. Do you know about this story?
I've heard like variants of it.
Harvard found that they were doing blind admissions.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, there were a lot of Jews being accepted into Harvard. So they literally said, well, we're looking for people with character.
Mm.
Now we're looking, you know, it's not just how you do on your SATs or what your grades are and how good a scholar you are. We're really looking for gentlemen who have character.
Right. Who weren't bar mitzvah. Kind of the character that comes from never eating matzah, that kind of character. And there was also, I believe, on the campus was formerly a medical school before Jews could go to medical school.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's there isn't a medical school there now, but there's a castle, like a...
Well, if you've got a college filled with Jews, do you really need a medical school?
Well, I mean, I feel like keep it in-house, vertically integrate, but there's not. So, and there's not even... Really, like my sister is a physical therapist and also went to Brandeis, and she had to do physical. She went through a course of study at Brandeis, but also had to take a couple outside classes because they don't do a lot of like super pre-professional stuff, which is like kind of neat because you get a breadth of study. But also when you're like, but this is what I want to do. It was mm-hmm. like a little hard for her. Like she had to take some anatomy other places and stuff.
Right. And the woman who accused Clarence Thomas, Anita Hill.
Anita Hill.
Teaches at Brandeis.
She does.
Yeah. Did you ever see her walking around campus?
No. Or maybe I did, but I wasn't. I never recognize people, even friends. It takes me forever to like, oh, I know that guy. Like even when I see the people at all out of context. So mm-hmm. I wouldn't have known anyway. We were at, gosh, where were we? Oh, we were somewhere in Brooklyn and we walked out of the store and my girlfriend was like, that was Ethan Hawke. And I was like, which one? And she's like, the one that looks like Ethan Hawke. I was like, oh, right.
Right. Yeah. Well, so you started doing comedy while you were at Brandeis. What did you major in?
English and creative writing. And I was a Spanish minor. So English and creative writing major.
English and creative writing and a Spanish minor.
Mm-hmm.
So like those guys in the Chilean mine who spoke
I was
Spanish?
Right. I was a Spanish-speaking mm-hmm. Subterranean or extraction specialist.
On a scale of 1 to 10, we'll give my joke a 2. That gets a 2.
I would give it a 6.
No, you're just being a 6.
A 6.
So when you say Spanish,
I haven't used my mining since college. It's just fallen away.
When you say a Spanish minor, you are studying
Spanish language and literature. And I took a couple. I think. At least one film course. I think it was just the one Spanish film course.
The one with the eye being slit.
Oh, I didn't see that. Was
the Bowie used to play that at the beginning of every one of his concerts.
Wasn't that?
I forgot the name.
Was that French, though? The Un Chien? Or no, maybe it was a Dolly thing, right? Un Chien Andalou.
Oh, right.
Because it's in the Pixies song, too. That's Debaser, where the lyric is slicing up eyeballs, ha, 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 ha. And it's a reference, and they say the name of the movie. Anyway, I think that's what we're talking
about. Yeah, I think you're right.
And it's
I
a
think
Dolly with a French name.
Right. Was Dolly Spanish?
I think so. Okay. That I could be very wrong about. I know very little.
This we are like going down. This is the problem with my show, by the way. It's not you. It has nothing to do with you. We go off into little tangents that have nothing to do with anything. I do remember that Bowie knew when he was supposed to go on stage because the audience would scream in horror of seeing the eye being slit.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
What a...
I went to the station-to-station concert that Bowie did, and he used to play that. Anyway, when I was into Bowie.
That's a gruesome way. That's a hole to dig for yourself.
Yes. But I'm reading the Cliff Nesteroff book.
Mm-hmm. How is it?
I know we have to get to you.
No, that's okay.
Comedians.
I would like to read that very much.
I was just reading the Cliff Nesteroff book, The Comedian. It's great. It's just the history of modern stand-up starting with vaudeville, and every page has this thing that just jumps out at you.
I love that. And especially because it ends with the stuff that's like, does it go towards the present? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it starts with vaudeville.
Great. That's awesome. I sometimes with nonfiction, my problem is I'm like, man, the Civil War is fascinating. And then like 300 pages into a 500 page book, I'm like, all right, enough of the Civil War. Like,
no, it's really a collection almost of trivia.
Great. That sounds super fun.
When you said digging a hole for yourself, I think it was Shecky Green who said, you know, anybody can kill. I'm bored. I want to go up and just create an absolute hole and then get out of it.
It is really fun.
Yeah.
When you feel the ability to do that, to like turn a crowd against you, knowing that you're going to bring them back, or like with the goal of bringing them back. It's very fun.
Well, you're successful. So let's talk about your success.
Thank you.
You have a great job. You're on the HBO series Last Week Tonight, John Oliver. Where, you know, deep dive has become part of the lexicon. I keep seeing it everywhere.
It's nice. I mean, it's nice to...
Who came up with deep dive?
I don't know. I think it certainly predates the show. And even what we do is kind of like a skimming off the top of a bunch of other stuff that's come before, you know?
Right.
But it's like fun to work on crafting these like longer comedy bits.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing that a British guy could sink his teeth into something. All right, that's a four.
I have to give that one a two, just because it's I know who signs my paychecks.
You know which side of who butters your biscuit or whatever. No, he's fantastic.
He's great. He's wonderful comedian and a wonderful person to work for.
Is this your first television writing job?
I did a very small amount of writing for Billy on the Street a couple of years ago. That was like done from home. And I went in for a meeting and kind of talked and then contributed some stuff freelance. But this is my first like writer's room that I've been in.
And how do you like the writer's room?
I like it. I like the balance of working on assignments kind of in my office, kind of hammering away in solitude or like working with one other person, and then the balance of spending the weekend more or less collaboratively. And I enjoy that, and I think it's something that you don't always get a lot of in stand-up, of just like banging out a bunch of jokes with other people. Because even when you write together, I think you kind of have your own goal where it's like you want to balance out, all right, well, we do one of mine, we do one of yours when you're working on writing with somebody. So it's nice to have like a common goal with the nine of us working on something. And it's fun.
How much reading do you have to do?
It's a lot of like the early part of the week is a lot of reading the news, or if you're working on a long story, it's a lot of reading like transcripts of footage that we're drawing from and research. And so it's like, it's a lot. And I feel like I'm definitely better informed when I'm in the office than when I'm on a break for even a week. I'll be like, what happened last week? Oh, no, I'm going to catch up.
Yeah, I don't want to violate any trusts. You know, I've heard the rumors about John Oliver putting guns in everybody's mouths and then jerking off. I'm just joking. I'm just kidding.
No, those are totally false. I feel like I know it's a joke, but I also have to be
it's
totally false. Like, just to be
I know. Believe me, I work for Robert Smigel, and He puts a gun in my mouth and forces me to jerk off. But that's
forces
a whole
you to jerk off.
Yeah, it's a
that's like a totally different. That's like an interesting. Yeah. That's a niche of a niche.
Yeah, I so I don't want to put you in an awkward position because I know that when you work on a show, mm-hmm. You leave because I've done these interviews and you're asked about the show and then you go, did I do anything? Did I violate a trust?
So I, sure.
I don't want to put you in a. But what I do like is I've had several jobs. The best job I ever had was working for Bill Maher because I got to read all the time.
Yeah.
I was paid to just sit and read. And I, the phone would ring and I'd be reading something and I can't talk now. I'm working.
I'm reading, yeah.
Yeah, I'm working.
I'm working. That's
I'm
great.
Working.
I do love, I mean, I really like it. And I think it when I'm working, I feel like I'm a better informed citizen mm-hmm. for sure. Because because not only am I reading the stuff that everybody puts across your vision, whether it's like something your parents want to talk about or something that comes up on your Facebook feed or Twitter, but I'm also it's kind of part of the job to like try to find stories that haven't been, you know, covered by other shows Monday through Thursday and Friday. So it's like nice to Monday through Friday. Most of the daily shows are, you know, Monday through Thursday.
So let's talk about reading more than most people do.
I would love to.
Because your job, you're paid mm-hmm. to read about civic issues that are essentially ignored by everybody except John Oliver, Rachel Maddow, and a couple of other people. But
yeah, I mean, all the stuff we do has like, you know, has grounding in other research and reporting that exists in the world.
But is not getting the attention.
Yeah, I guess that's I think it's fun to try to find things that are like under the radar.
And the things that are under the radar mm-hmm. are mind-boggling and mind-blowing.
Yeah, there's...
Well, why, you know, you say, well, why isn't this the lead story? Mm-hmm. And what do you think the forces at work... What do you think... Why do you think they're not the lead stories?
I guess... Oh, gosh, that's a lofty question to comment on. I think, though, it seems like when you watch and read a lot of news, it's like it's a competitive business. And it seems like sometimes it's good business to lead with Donald Trump said awful thing
mm-hmm.
Because that's people are responding to that on like a level of clicking or watching and it's sometimes easiest to let the loudest voices.
Yeah.
That's the George Saunders essay, right? The brain dead megaphone of like just the loudest thing draws the most attention, even if it's not the most interesting or compelling thing. It just is louder than everything else. So people have to crane their necks towards it because they want to know what this big commotion is about. And I think it's sometimes hard when that's what people are interested in to avert what you're doing away from it.
Yeah. And it's so, as I was listening to Meet the Press today, we're recording this on Sunday. This is going up Monday night. And they were talking about Donald Trump, who is bringing up Bill Clinton's lady problems mm-hmm. because Bill Clinton now is going to be campaigning in New Hampshire. Well, the lady problems was a distraction 15 years ago and is a distraction now. Meanwhile, there was a story in the New York Times about Donald Trump's older brother, 8 years older, died of alcoholism, didn't fit the Trump mold. The father wanted him to do a specific thing, go into the family business. He wanted to be an aviator, and he drank himself to death. And it really gives you insight into the Freudian conflict that Donald Trump
sure.
exemplifies and looked up to his brother but was competitive with him and then got the brother written out of the will and
wow.
the older brother had a child with cerebral palsy and Donald was footing the bill for the cerebral palsy treatments mm-hmm. but then when the father died when Donald Trump's father died
yeah.
The older brother's wife and kids were written out of the will, So they challenged the will. So Donald stopped paying the bills for the kid with cerebral palsy. And it's so much insight into who this guy really is and what he represents. And that is, America is great if you fit the mold. If you're the guy who does what your father wants to do, you can inherit the business, you can have everything. But if you're the older brother who wants to fly and not go into the family business, you're going to be ostracized. And that is the America of Donald Trump. It works for you if you're lucky and you're ruthless and you want what the richest 1% want. If you don't, you're screwed. No conversation about that on Meet the Press. Just, you know, is Donald Trump wrong for going after Hillary's husband's lady's problems?
Yeah, it's I don't know. I've never worked in like news media, so I don't know exactly what guides those decisions. But it's like sometimes you'd hope that the deeper issues of that would get touched upon, especially if you're gonna, you know, if you're gonna be talking to this person who seems to have found a loophole in the system wherein whatever you can just say whatever you want. Like, I think we haven't caught up to that yet, that there are people now that are just like, oh, we don't have to be we don't have to spin anything anymore. I'll just say whatever I want, and then nobody will say the opposite better than I said the lie, which is like fascinating. Right. I'm fascinated by that. Just like, oh, you can just say a thing, and then if nobody corrects you, then that's the new truth.
Right. Right. I had Steve Forbes on the show. A lot of people complained to me that I had Steve Forbes on because this is an echo chamber, but I feel we should have other people representing other views. And he kind of steamrolled me on some facts and I talked to him about this. I said, I think the problem is live radio and live television because you don't have time to just stop and say, whoa, 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 stop, stop. What you just said is factually inaccurate. You're always getting a countdown clock with live radio and live television. That's why 60 Minutes is so terrifying to politicians. The idea that Carly Fiorina can claim that she saw that Planned Parenthood video that doesn't exist. And when she's called on it, she says, I saw it.
Yeah.
I saw. And if you and it's what Goebbels said about repeating the lie over and over again. There is now evidence coming forth that there were Muslims celebrating after 9/11. If you just repeat it over, Joe Trump insists that he saw Muslims celebrating.
Thousands.
Enough evidence to keep the lie going.
Yeah, it's fascinating. I just, it was brought up pre-show, but Making a Murderer, I just watched, which is like so fascinating.
On Netflix.
Yeah, and such a like harrowing display of like, if you say a thing, the people that heard it will have always heard it from that point on, regardless of like the amount of truth that's in it. So that's always like part of their consciousness.
So you're one of the most, and I'm not embarrassing you, it's you're paid to be one of the most knowledgeable people we have on this show because your job is to have knowledge.
My job is to have knowledge.
Yes, it is.
And to turn that into comedy. But I don't know if I'm one of the most knowledgeable. I think that is a kind compliment.
So what are your web hobbies? Like, when you're on the web, where do you tend to go? Is it The Nation, The Daily Kos, Talking Points, Memo? What
I do, I try to go to sites with, I read a lot of Guardian just because it has more international stories, and that's like useful for me for work. So I do a lot of that. I will go through New York Times, Washington Post. I have like a pretty decently curated. I go to Twitter also and stuff like that to see, specifically Twitter though, to see like what people are talking about and where they're sourcing things from.
Do you have two separate Twitter accounts?
I use my own, but I'm a slightly too frequent refresher. Mm-hmm. So I'll see. I follow like a mixture of people that work in.
So tell me how you start, because I have two separate Twitter mm-hmm. accounts. I have a fake Twitter account mm-hmm. where it's just news sources
sure.
that I go to, and I don't even come. And then I have my the regular one. Tell me like how you start your day to find things out.
Sure.
Talk me through. What time do you get up in the morning?
Right there, about 8.
8 a.m.?
Yeah. Walk the dog.
Okay.
Don't learn a lot from that.
No.
I mean, just about the...
Well, if you didn't walk the... If the dog took a crap on the newspaper in the house, you could have
That's
something
true.
To read.
Yes. Or, yeah. I'm mostly learning about the dog's digestive health.
Yeah.
And her general interest in... I learned a lot about the cleanliness of our sidewalks, the Brooklyn sidewalks. That's the big illuminating
This is the
experience.
Rescue.
Yeah, it's we adopted
a pug.
Yeah,
an ugly dog.
Oh, she's so cute though. She's such a sweetie. She's very small and snuggly, which is helpful in our. She's for a pug pretty quiet, and we have a white noise machine for sleeping, and it kind of the pug's snoring and the white noise machine. Almost vibrate against each other back to nothing.
Now, when you say white noise machine, you're talking about Fox News or an actual white noise?
Yeah.
That gets 1.5. Boy, I am.
You rated yourself below Spanish minor.
So you go to the web and you start looking at what?
Yeah, I look.
First thing you look, do you have like a ritual? Do you have to go to one thing first? Are you
anal?
There are
a few things. There's like a, no, I'm not at all.
Okay.
I will, so I guess the first thing I'll do is like, if something has come across my social media, because, first thing in the morning I'll check my email and Twitter and Facebook and whatnot before I go to work. And if something jumps out at me as like an interesting story, then I'll investigate that more deeply to be like, what's there to this? Mm-hmm. Are people just like saying something or is there something interesting there? And then from there, it's like kind of through a few, I'll look at the, Times first, usually just because they have a pretty thorough
mm-hmm.
Accounting of things. And then Post, Guardian, Newser, which, have you ever been there?
Yeah, it's gone downhill for me lately. But
I haven't been on in a few weeks just because I've been less engaged. But I like that just because it's like a broad variety of things.
Right.
And then sometimes I'll even just like look at, sometimes it helps me to go like, what's trending on Facebook
right.
even to be like, oh, what are the stories that are the unignorable mm-hmm. stories this week that everybody seems to be interested in?
I always tell my kids you should read the editorials in the New York Times because mm-hmm. that's the first thing President Obama reads, I assume, is he turns to the New York Times and probably the Washington Post mm-hmm. every day. This is what Barack Obama is reading in Hawaii. He is reading The Whites by Richard Price. It's a detective novel.
That sounds fun.
About the cold cases
mm-hmm.
that got away. Purity by Jonathan Franzen.
Sure.
The Wright Brothers by David McCullough.
Mm-hmm.
And the Three Body Problem by Liu Cixin. I don't know. It's an Asian name, so I don't know what that is. Do you think the president is really reading Jonathan Franzen?
I don't know if he's going to go cover to cover on Purity. Maybe he is. Maybe he loves. Maybe he loved Freedom. But like, I don't. That's tough. Because I'm not nearly as busy as the president, and I don't read a lot of novels. Yeah, that's a lot. That's like
when you say cover to cover. Can you read Jonathan Franzen without going cover to cover? Can you do that?
What I mean, I don't mean like skimming. I just mean like you read a chunk and then you get engrossed by something else and you kind of leave it off.
That's what happened to me with the corrections.
Yeah,
but like the Wright Brothers, you can skim.
Totally, I think again we're talking about nonfiction. It's like, oh, then this is a chapter about one of their kids. Blah blah blah. Okay, I want to read about the airplanes.
Although, he had a really interesting interview in the New York Review of Books
mm-hmm.
with a novelist 2 months ago. And I can't remember I can't remember her name. But anyway, I'm going, how the hell does this guy know this much? I can't even remember the woman's name, but how does How can he have a conversation with a novelist when he's in the Situation Room?
Yeah.
And dealing with, I'm always fascinated by how these people manage their time. Seinfeld spent some time with President Obama.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing. Did you see it?
I haven't seen it yet. No, the comedians and cars.
Obama is just the coolest guy in the world. And yeah, I really recommend it.
I will check that out. He's done a lot of comedy stuff really mm-hmm. well.
Oh, he's really great at it. So your Twitter account, Modern Seinfeld, it's kind of interesting. Larry David knows about it.
Yes.
Does Jerry know about it?
I believe he does, but I'm not 100% certain. I've heard rumors that he's heard about it through like third-party sources.
Well, what spawned the idea of the Modern Seinfeld Twitter account?
I was just hanging out. I was talking with my friend Dan Bulger, who's a Boston comedian, very funny, and Boston-based. And he said, we were just chatting, and he was like, you know, you wouldn't have any Seinfeld episodes if they'd had cell phones, which is very funny to think mm-hmm. about. But also, I think you would lose half a dozen episodes, and you would gain hundreds. That was my counter thesis. So I just started tweeting from my own account just about modern plot lines of Seinfeld mm-hmm. that couldn't have happened then. And my friend Jack Moore saw that and was like, oh, this is a thing. So he grabbed the handle really quickly and we started writing it together.
When was this?
This was December 2012.
And it took off when?
Right away. Like within a day. It became huge.
And people started adding to it.
People were tweeting back at us stories, but it's all the stuff we've run with. I think at first we'd retweeted a couple others, but all the stuff that's on there is just like we didn't solicit submissions, and we like if people sent stuff, we'd be like, you know, this is well, really what we
this
do.
Is kind of interesting because you're working for Last Week Tonight, which is not a sitcom. I want to read some of these tweets because they're hysterical, ask you if you've been approached by anyone. Seinfeld today. Jerry gets paranoid about his girlfriend's past when her iPhone automatically connects to the Wi-Fi at Newman's apartment.
Yeah.
Now, that is a great pitch. You know, they always say in sitcoms, you need a log line.
Yeah.
What's your pitch? Well, there it is. I mean, if some guy's running a show, that is a perfect Seinfeld pitch.
I think that was a Jack one. And he is now a sitcom writer by trade. He very quickly got into that line of work.
From this
was kind of the springboard. I mean, he had scripts and stuff. So he had done the prerequisites. And then this was kind of the thing that like put him in the conversation of like, oh, this is a guy we should look at. I believe.
This is fantastic. Listen to this one. Seinfeld today. And this is 140 characters. Elaine accidentally does a British accent in a job interview after marathoning Downton Abbey. She gets the job and has to keep faking it.
I like that. That's fun.
I mean, that is absolutely brilliant.
Well, thank you.
And it's 140 characters.
Yeah.
And that's I would say, for a Seinfeld, that's one quarter of a Seinfeld.
Right, because that's like it's an Elaine story, so you need Jerry and George. You know, it's like one of the several storylines. But my favorite Elaine, I think, the first one I wrote, so it always sticks out to me, and was never on the Modern Seinfeld one. It was just tweeted from my account, was Elaine sleeps with her upstairs neighbor and then breaks up with him, prompting him to make his Wi-Fi network name an insult against her. And won't change it until she meets conditions.
Right.
So that was, I mean, it's like, the fun thing about it is we're sitting on the shoulders of giants in the way that all four of the principal characters have such a strong point of view and such a strong set of habits and hobbies and, perspective that anything that happens in the world now, you can be like, oh, one of them will have an interesting reaction to it. Whether, because sometimes the topical ones go super huge in terms of retweets and stuff because it's like it feels like we're reacting to the news, but in a way that's like, oh, this is the character of George Costanza reacting to the news.
What's another sitcom that you watch a lot?
I love Parks and Recreation.
Okay.
One of my favorites. Current with Brooklyn Nine-Nine, which I like very much.
But I mean, you know, Jerry gets paranoid about his girlfriend's past when her iPhone automatically connects to the Wi-Fi at Newman's apartment. Mm-hmm. That is great. Could that apply to friends?
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a pretty broad one.
Yeah. Elaine accidentally does a British accent in a job interview after marathoning Downton Abbey. She gets the job and has to keep faking it. It's a brilliant idea. But that you could transpose that.
Yeah, that could be somewhere else too. It just felt to me that feels so mm-hmm. like you can imagine Julia Louis-Dreyfus playing that very easily.
Right.
Yeah, I guess it's broader. It's broader than that. But the Seinfeld lens really helps you focus. You know, rather than just writing in the dark. For
how great is Seinfeld?
Great.
Why?
I think this a lot. I think that not only were the performances brilliant and the writing super tight, so everything's really fully realized. But my favorite thing about Seinfeld is that it puts a name, it names things that we didn't know needed naming, and it describes things like a great stand-up bit that we didn't know needed describing.
What do you mean?
Like the idea of he's a close talker. People didn't say that before. You know what I mean? That mm-hmm. was a thing that was coined. Like they've coined so many things that we forget were coined in Seinfeld. Regifting was like a Seinfeld.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's like that was a thing people did and then they put it on TV and then everyone's like, oh, that's the word for that phenomenon. And to me, that's like the highest form of like pop culture achievement is when you do a thing that now that's the name of that.
In the beginning, there was the word.
Yeah.
Without a word for something, it doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So it's all swimming around in the ether, and what Seinfeld did was isolate something, and then it made sense of something.
Yeah, it was almost like the comedy version of one of those murder-solving boards with yarn that connects stuff, and uh-huh. then you see the connections where you didn't know they were before. And I think that they did that. Or it's like even the loftiest way I've ever thought to describe it was like what's in a name, right? Mm-hmm. A rose without a name would smell as sweet from Romeo and Juliet. And it's like, yeah, but nobody else would know that it was a rose. And if you talked about it, you'd have to describe it for an hour. And then they would be like, oh, that flower, it's red, it's got the thorns. And like when someone goes, oh, yeah, you mean a rose? That's like so powerful. Right. So that everyone has this
common
vocabulary.
It smells better if you know it's a rose.
Yeah. And
if you're blindfolded mm-hmm. and you don't know it's a rose, it won't smell
right,
as sweet.
Right. It's like the Pepsi challenge.
Really? What?
Right. When you would get blindfolded, it was the blind taste test that Pepsi said made it was when Coke was number one and Pepsi did this blind taste test that Pepsi came out on top and said, look, we're the best. You just want it because it's called Coke.
Right.
So you like it better when it's called the thing you like already.
And is that wrong? That may not necessarily be wrong.
I don't think so. And I think there was also Malcolm Gladwell wrote a thing about Pepsi being sweeter, so people like it better when you take the first sip, whereas Coke is slightly less sweet, so you can drink a whole can of it easier, and so it wins those taste tests. I don't know the science there.
I mean, to me, you go to Denny's and you see the omelet, yep. the vegetarian omelet. They have a picture of it, and you point to that picture, and they bring you something, and it doesn't look like what's in the picture, but you kind of are imagining what's in the picture while you're eating the
yeah.
junk, and it does make it tastier. I would assume, I do know a couple of very rich men who are able to hire porn stars mm-hmm. to satisfy them.
Sure.
And I've asked them about this, and they won't. I assume the video is what wags the actual sex with these porn stars.
Sure.
Because to me, the video is like the word.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it's the thing that defines what this sex is all
yeah.
about.
And it's the idea of like this person is a recognizable figure,
mm-hmm.
and they are we are together now, right? Like it's like a human version of like conspicuous consumption. It feels like. Like wearing, like the difference between a Rolex and like a fake Rolex, which I'm sorry to be, if that's, it's, I think, dehumanizing to say, but I think that's like the principle at work, right?
Yes. In fact, in high school, you, I would assume, are you care who you sleep with. Let's just say I don't know who slept with whom, but I'm just saying, like, it's the status of.
It's a status thing, right?
Right.
To sleep with a porn star puts you in the conversation of porn star sex,
mm-hmm.
which is a conversation that, I don't know, otherwise you would just pay someone to tell someone that is true about you.
Right. Did you ever, like, shop for something and like something that was less expensive than the more expensive thing, but be confused, like, well, I like this, but why is this more expensive? Like, shouldn't I be getting this if it's more expensive?
All the time. I just bought a watch online, and, excuse me, there were, like, some that were, there was a style that I liked that only came in either smartwatches, which I did not want, or, like, very expensive watches. And I was like, no, I'm not going to spend this much. But then once that was in my mind, I was like, well, is this one that's $30, like, not a good thing to have? And I was like, probably it's fine. And the difference between, like, I don't need a $500 watch in my life. That's just more than I need. But it
you don't know that if you get a $500 watch, you live longer?
Is that true?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well,
different time.
I'm going to cancel the Amazon order from that's what he's from a different time. He has a much more expensive watch. So that I think it would, like, put in my head, like, oh, well, is this not okay to get? And I ended up, like, paying. It ended up, I considered buying watches that were much more expensive. Once I saw that there was a $500 watch, I looked at the $275 watch being like, well, that's not so bad. Mm-hmm. And I didn't get it, but it, like, definitely, there was that idea of, like, oh, well, that's what the spectrum is.
I find the $10 questions on Jeopardy are much more satisfying than the $200 questions on Jeopardy. I'm just making a really bad joke. Why would you wear a watch?
I'm buying a watch because I found myself out to lunch with someone and looking at my phone periodically in a way that I mimed looking at a watch, but I was looking at my phone periodically in a way that felt disrespectful, in a way that's more disrespectful than looking at a watch, because, like, people get that you have to, like, if I go, hey, I have to leave around 3 and I'm looking to make sure that it's around 3. People get that. But if you're looking at your phone, I think people get that too. But it's definitely like, oh, he's not looking at his
time. Are people aware that when you check your phone in a conversation, that you are saying to the other person, I'm losing interest in you?
I think people feel that way. And it's often true, but I don't think it's always true. But that's why I wanted to get a watch. So I wouldn't send that message by accident. If I was like, oh, this is a really great conversation, how much time has gone by, that I don't look at my phone and send the message of, like, oh, I'm going to see if anyone texted me. I'm just like, oh, cool. Okay, do I have to go to a show now?
The Waldorf school.
Mm-hmm.
The Waldorf, it's like a German schooling for kids that was invented 100 years ago, right?
I think, and then it's like a method of education, and it's all over the place now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was just reading that in Silicon Valley, all the tycoons are sending their precious children to these Waldorf schools where their precious children are being told to put away their tablets and their phones and look at one another. Mm-hmm. And the high-tech Silicon Valley guys are going, what, what? And the Waldorf teachers are having to explain, no, 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 what you make is dehumanizing.
Yeah.
It's actually bad for kids.
Yeah, especially for very small kids.
Mm-hmm.
It's, like, scientifically bad for them, right? Until a certain age, it's just like, oh, don't. Mm. I think there's something to – I'm not anti-technology. I'm, like, very – I don't find – I was just out – I was on vacation with my girlfriend and her family, and I found it a very anxious experience to have limited access to my phone. I didn't find unplugging to be, like, a delightful, freeing experience.
Mm-hmm.
However, I do try to minimize, like, my relationship with technology's effect on my relationship with people. Like, I try not to prioritize technology over people.
Right.
Especially when you're present with them.
Right. Absolutely. They've also, in this article that I read, they kind of demystified the myth that there's a technology gap in our country. You know, Los Angeles public school system spent like $1.5 billion to put iPads in the schools, and that was a from what I understand, that was a disaster. And they kept saying, well, poor kids, African-Americans don't have access to the same computers as white kids. And now it turns out that African-American teenagers have more technology than white teenagers.
Oh, fascinating.
Yeah, there's no digital gap in the African-American community. Between the African-Americans and the whites.
With teenagers.
Yeah.
Huh.
So this idea that we have to spend all this money making children computer literate when what we really need to do is just make them literate.
Right. Yeah. I think, right. Like the iPad, access to an iPad is not the difference between a good education and a bad education.
Right.
You can get a terrible education and you could be in a room with floor-to-ceiling iPads and not learn anything.
Anger in America.
What about it?
I've been saying on this show since 2012 that women in 2012 all decided to be angry at David Feldman. that David Feldman is the problem. But I did say that after the 2012 presidential elections, women got scared and they realized climate change is real. Men don't understand how contraception works. If we don't stop this, there's going to be no planet left.
Mm-hmm.
And people say to me, you can't back that up and that you're just being paranoid. Your marital problems are influencing your observation. But I keep saying women are angrier than they have been in the past. And a new study out, NBC and Esquire did a poll. Do you know who the angriest people in America are, angrier than African-Americans? Women.
The angriest people?
Are the angriest people in America right now. Women are angrier than men in America.
Hmm.
And that makes me happy. It makes me less angry.
That's feeling the validation of that?
Yeah, and I think, and it makes me realize that it's not my fault that all these women are angry at me.
No, I would, I was agreeing before you heard the last clause of that sentence. It is definitely not your fault that women are angry. The at you I can't vouch for.
Well, don't you think that you tend to channel all your rage to what's right in front of you?
Huh. Let me think if that's what I do. I guess.
You're married.
Long-term relationship.
Okay.
Living with my girlfriend.
Okay. I'm not going to pry into your personal life. Would you say that you've noticed women are angrier? And do they have a right to be angrier?
I would say over the I would say if we're talking about since 2012, I would say women certainly have a right to be angry. I haven't noticed whether they're angrier, but I think there's certainly a right to be angry. And a lot of the, like, there's a lot of distressing political, with access to medical care specifically.
Yeah, Planned Parenthood.
Planned Parenthood specifically. It's like, that's a thing that is even more than in the way of, like, well, everyone's feelings are valid. Even more than that. That's like a thing to get, like, scared and angry about, I think. I don't blame men or women for feeling that way. But it's something that definitely acutely comes down on women. I would not blame women for that.
Yeah. I'm so glad we can talk about why women should or should not be angry without a woman present.
Sure.
That way we're, objective. But here's why women are angry. And this will really endear me to the female listener out there who I have. Actually, I do have female listeners. I'm amazed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I'm amazed, because women tend to listen. They do, and they talk. Okay. Studies have shown that when a rat is placed in a maze, and you put the cheese at the end, and the rat is in the maze trying to ferret out the cheese, that's not a good ferret and rat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Too close. Too close for the metaphor to...
Yeah. Sniff out the cheese. That if you design the maze so that that he can get close or she can get close to the cheese but not find it, the rat becomes very agitated and then angry and violent.
Yeah.
So the closer the rat gets to the cheese and finds herself unable to get the cheese, the more angry that rat becomes. So I am saying that women are rats and cheese is equality.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
No.
I think they smell the equality.
I think there's definitely, on a human level, I think there's something to that as well. Like there's
they smell the equality. And let me tell you something, ladies. Equality smells like cheese.
It does.
And it goes bad. And it stinks what it.
Closing the pay gap is like an aged Parmesan. I understand that. And you want to eat, and without it, you get spaghetti, you get marinara. What kind of dinner are you having?
And your cholesterol is going to go up.
Yep.
But cheese is not good for you.
But that it's choice. It's the choice. The choice for cheese. That's my new book about income inequality in America. You can buy it never.
Yeah. What were you saying? I interrupted you.
Oh, I was just saying there's something on a human level, I think, to being more frustrated when something seems just out of your grasp than when something seems indomitably far off or like inachievably far off. Just like accomplishing a goal in your personal goal, career goal feels I think probably it takes up more of your mental real estate, I imagine, when it feels close than when it feels really far. And
as a Jew,
yeah,
I was raised to not expect too much from America. Were you raised that way?
I don't think
that there were limits to what I could achieve, that anything is possible, but in the end, you're going to still be on the outside looking in.
I did not receive that message.
Well, I'm telling you right now.
That explains most of my life.
Mm-hmm.
This, I wish somebody would have told me younger. No, but I understand that. And it's like there's something I think that's like when you don't think something is possible, then it doesn't frustrate you as much.
Mm-hmm.
Even if you're worse off than you would be if you were like striving for that. Like I will never walk on Mars and it doesn't bother me. Because I don't think about it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I think if there were something that I felt in my own life were possible and just outside my grasp, it would frustrate me a lot more. Like the idea of even if it's a smaller thing or maybe a larger thing.
Mm.
Like if I really wanted to learn a skill or to accomplish like a fitness goal or it's hard to make the exact allegory because like as a white male person, I have pretty much the full docket of rights in America. But if there was something that was being denied to me that I wanted and felt like was close, oh, all it would take is this is a local legislator or a state legislator or a federal legislator making a change and they just won't do it. That's so much more frustrating than like, I'll never dunk, you know, because that just seems to me that's like walking on Mars.
Right, right. I think Martin Luther King, a couple of other African-Americans talked about happiness. Oh, Fareed Zakaria has an interesting article. We talked about it on the previous show about how white middle-aged men are the dyingest group in America, that our mortality rates are going up while everybody else's rates are going down. And so why are middle-aged white men dying? And it's because we drink too much, we eat too much, we smoke too much, and we have a sense of entitlement.
Mm-hmm.
And when that sense of entitlement doesn't come to fruition, we gamble and get angry and turn on ourselves and die, as well we should. But if you're not expected to do that well in this country. Yeah, I'm always envious of the children of immigrants because they're expected to do well, but not too well, right?
I know what you're saying. I think it's hard. You know, you're starting off with being kind of an outsider to the culture and within. But I don't know. I think there's that like often heard immigrant tale of like the immigrant tale. Like I'm from the 1800s.
They do have tales. Well, they have tales.
Well, you're thinking of Feifel Goes West in American Tale. He was specifically a mouse.
Feifel Moskowitz.
Yes.
Mouskowitz.
Yes. I think you hear both ways, right? Of the like high pressure parents who were of the first generation Americans.
Right.
So I think there's like, I don't know. It's always.
This is a question I always ask Jews.
So complicated.
I always ask Jews this question.
Please.
Third generation Jew or second generation Jew? How many of your grandparents?
My grandparents were born in America.
All four of your grandparents were born in America.
Yeah.
All four of my grandparents were not born in America. Mm-hmm. I'm older than you.
Mm-hmm.
There's a big difference between Jews whose grandparents were not born in America. And,
yeah, I think so too. I think for sure. My grandparents were all born in America, I believe.
I think you're less neurotic if all four of your grandparents were born in America because you're kind of raised to realize it's going to be okay. You're in America now.
Mm-hmm.
I had four grandparents who were beaten dogs.
Mm-hmm. I think my grandparents, I knew one great grandmother, but I didn't have those like tales, the like disheartening, dehumanizing tales of like what made them leave.
They all had PTSD.
Mm-hmm.
Every single one of my four grandparents mm-hmm. had post-traumatic stress syndrome, either from the Holocaust or the pogroms or being married to one another.
Mm-hmm. One of three equivalently difficult statuses.
And, you know, the twitches and anxiety and mm-hmm. depression that was external, wasn't caused by a chemical imbalance.
Right.
It was you got to leave your shtetl because they're coming to rape you.
Yeah.
You know, and you're not entitled to your feelings. That's the so they raise your if you're the child of an immigrant. I'm not just talking about the Jewish experience, mm-hmm. but I guarantee you it's the same thing with the Guatemalans and the Mexicans and maybe not the Canadians, but that if your mother or father came to this country, you're not allowed to own your feelings. You're not allowed to feel anything.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't know how bad we had it.
Right. As a descendant of Fiddler on the Roof Jews.
Yes. By the way, we were working Caroline's Christmas Day.
Yeah.
Did you see the people lining up to go see Fiddler on the Roof?
I did not see
them. I took their pictures.
That's very funny.
I should post it. Though, to me, I wanted to get a bullhorn because it was Christmas Day and they're lining up to see Fiddler on the Roof. And I just, we get it. You're a defiant Jew. Yeah.
You're very Jewish. Could you involve yourself in a more Jewish pursuit today?
Were you bar mitzvahed?
I was.
How important is your godless faith?
I'm very secular. Very secular. But I like tradition.
Do you like being Jewish?
I do. I do. I like it. I think that there's growing up American Judaism, I think, has a lot less baggage attached to it than my friends who are like raised Catholic. I feel like I have a lot less religious qualms because I feel like it take or leave as a buffet, and nobody in my family has ever made me feel, especially my parents, have never made me feel like bad about that. It's not like a cultural, I don't have friends that are like, you should be more like your poor mother. So I think it's a very, it's an easy religious identity to like take the parts that I like and leave off the parts that I like less.
Mm-hmm.
Like to me, a really lovely idea is the idea of, and I do it most years. I think I lapsed last year, But the idea of on and around Yom Kippur, between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, mending fences with people that you might have wronged in the previous year. And I think that's like a really – it's a practical thing to do, and it's like a lovely reminder of like, hey, this is a good – it's a good housekeeping measure for your own life to do at that time. But like what's – you know, there are certain things that are less important to me religiously. And I think that it's easy to I haven't had a hard time like saying I'm a Jewish person without you know, going to shul twice a week. Or
can I ask you about Israel?
Man, that's tough. It's just so. It's a my best friend, from my whole life.
What's tough about Israel?
Just the. What isn't tough about Israel? Because I feel like it's such a fraught climate, and there's like not only Israel itself and the conflicts, the intra-national, and obviously depending on the status linguistically that you grant the Palestinian people as a nation. But like globally, it's so fraught with it as a part of the larger fabric. And then there's the Jewish part of like, I think I have less heart attachment to Israel than my parents and grandparents, certainly. Right. As like a Jew who has grown up in America, as my parents and grandparents also did. So right. I think there's less of that like gut Holocaust anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
Driving it. And my best friend from childhood lives in Tel Aviv and has for 6 years, 7 years. And it's something that I think about a lot but haven't come to any firm conclusions on.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a bone of contention because my kids don't have the connection to Israel that I have. You want to hear my theory about anti-Semitism?
Sure.
I would say if you take 100 people with no ethnicity, no religion, of those 100 people, 3 of them are good, and the 97 are horrific, right?
I would give you a few more. I think that's a core difference, but I would like to hear more.
Okay, for comedic purposes, sure. Let's just say
3%
out of 100 human beings are people you want to hang out with.
Sure.
Is that a fair statement?
Yeah.
Okay. This is why there's anti-Semitism. Jewish people tend to read a lot, if they can read, if they don't have dyslexia. But, you know, they like to read more than I think most people. Right? Is that fair? There's a lot of reading going on.
There's a lot of reading going on.
And a lot of talking going on.
Sure.
And a lot of conversation going on. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you were to take 100 Jews, put them in a room, 3 of those Jews would be worth being friendly with, right?
Sure. As a subset of the 100 people theory, the 3 out of 100 people theory.
Right. So there are 97 Jews who you should stay away from, but 3 Jews that you would want to be friendly with.
Right.
But
3 Jews you'd watch a basketball game with. Or,
yeah.
Yeah.
But of those 97 Jews who you should be staying away from, they're probably good conversationalists. They're probably well-read. They probably like to share their love of food and music and knowledge. And they can seduce you into actually believing that they're not a pain in the ass. And then when you find out that they're a pain in the ass, like the other 97 people out of 100 who aren't Jewish, you go, these effing Jews, they got me.
I've been hoodwinked into friendship again. I've been swindled into acquaintanceship with another guy.
Does that make any sense?
I hear what you're saying. I don't know if it tracks all the way through.
Okay, I'm going to keep this in. This is anecdotal evidence of traveling around the country. Because I'm Jewish, I tend to meet Jewish people at comedy clubs.
Mm-hmm.
They walk up to me.
Yes.
And, you know, they make a pretty nice first impression. if you're into opinionated, argumentative New York Times reading professionals.
Sure.
Is that a fair?
Yeah.
But only 3% of them are worthy of friendship. But it takes a while to find out that they're not part of that 3%.
So you're saying...
And that's where the anti-Semitism comes from.
So you're
from.
Saying other non-Jews are easier to understand on face value. You go, oh, that guy's pretty cool. Or like, that guy's a jerk and he's going to stay a jerk.
Yes.
Okay.
So what I'm telling Jews are... what I'm telling the Jews is if you're not part of the 3%, just tell me up front. Don't quote something from the New York Times. Don't, if you're an asshole, be an asshole. Mm-hmm. Don't.
Yeah, don't give me your first date self.
All right, can you stick around for some premium content?
Sure.
Good. Josh Gondelman. Oh, I didn't ask you about your book. We'll come back and talk about You Blew It, an awkward look at the many ways in which you've already ruined your life. If you want to listen to our premium content, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. And for $5 a month, you get access to all our premium content. We won't be selling this. It's just part of the premium content. Cool. And it helps keep the lights on here, except on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Well, then the Shabbos going helps keep the lights on.
Will you come back?
Yeah, of course.
Let's plug all your gigs. What is your Twitter handle?
At Josh Gondelman.
Yes.
And at Seinfeld Today for the Modern Seinfeld.
Uh-huh.
Find me at, what else? Stand-up stuff?
Yeah.
My next big stand-up show is, maybe this will be up by then, is January 11th. Aparna Nancherla and I are doing a show at Union Hall. So it's Monday, January 11th at 8 p.m., doors at 7:30, and it'll be really fun. We're each doing a long set, so it's not one of those, if you want to see one of us, you'll come and we'll do 7 minutes you'll not have gotten what you thought you were getting. So
that's
we're each
a
doing
great
a long
show.
Set. And thank you. And Naomi Ekparagon is hosting, and she's really, really, really funny too. Yeah, so
you're a great stand-up. And
thank you.
Buy your book, You Blew It, an awkward look at the many ways in which you've already ruined your life. Before we go, very quickly, tell me what that book is about and why everybody should buy it.
So the book is about how even under the best of circumstances, everything is kind of a nightmare and that's okay. We're all just doing our best. And it's funny. It's like the idea is here's why we get it, that it's terrible. Even getting a massage. Here's why getting a massage is terrible. And here's why your mom being on Facebook is terrible, which is like a little more obvious. And then here's why it's terrible to have a party where friends that don't know each other meet. And it just kind of goes through like, this is why the world is, even when you're under the best of circumstances, still a relentless nightmare.
Great. Buy it. You Blew It, an awkward look at the many ways in which you've already ruined your life. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, do all your shopping on Amazon. Via my website. Follow me on Twitter. Friend me on Facebook. From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.